that will go into a strong EPA that is able to actually act as a viable unit that enforces climate discipline and environmental laws, even within the federal territories, it's going to need a lot more teeth than it has today. And there's no rocket science. There are models. We have created it. It's waiting. Pakistan is in a financial squeeze. And guess what goes out the door first when there's a financial squeeze? Climate money, climate goals. Because it's not immediate, right? Balancing the current account deficit or whatever, that's more immediate. The forex account, of course it is. And so when the flood hits, where is all the climate loans, even the World Bank ones, go? They get repurposed. They get repurposed first, immediately, to provide frontline relief for the 70 billion rupees needed immediately for the first line relief through the BISP program to provide people just the basic 20 cash grant or more or less, whatever is needed to get through the at least 1 month or 1 week of that great flood, or to areas where relief cannot reach, and to wait out the cycle of rehabilitation. You all know that the scale of post-flood distress has been great in parts of Sindh and Balochistan, and it continues that way. The winter of discontent passed, people have forgotten, cameras have moved on. The human misery still continues to change lives. It has altered many futures, particularly women and children, who remain 14 times more impacted in any flood event or any catastrophe of this nature than others. They don't get talked about because they have no voice. So I appreciate that the World Bank includes them in its model of inclusive planning. Now, I do want to say that the World Bank has a crucial role to play in addressing the urgent challenges of climate change. It's leveling up in Pakistan to the best of its abilities, but as a broader multilateral funder, the group is one of the biggest that addresses and finances climate change. It is. So where are we today with how countries like Pakistan fare just on the path to recovery and then, of course, building resilience? Resilience, building resilience has become the catchword, the buzzword of the year. Climate resilience can even, and our logo can even get you funds. That's how it works. That's not what it should stop at. It must mean building actual resilience on the ground, and for that, the World Bank says that this entire country climate report just to remain and build resilience, to keep our heads literally and metaphorically above water, $348 billion are needed till 2030. I said that very quickly because it's just a figure I can't wrap my head around in terms of how it will be generated. $348 million, am I right? Billion, am I right? Now, that's a huge figure until 2030, and 2030 is not very far away. It's not next century, it's not even 2050. And that is the trajectory to which a lot of our very ambitious, I would say sometimes over-ambitious, NDCs are attached. The national, determined contributions, most of our mitigation goals, which remain unfunded. What's happening today is that the conditional part of those goals, the 35% that is to be financed, is not coming. There seems to be no money in the country system or outside it to fund energy transitions. So when I start raising this issue, let me be very clear, I'm going to be speaking to the power and energy sectors to be looking at building support for a just energy transition package. They're called JETPs. Indonesia has benefited from it, and it's time to start looking at it. Maybe you can help them, and we can put together something for the energy ministry to look at a just energy transition. Now, the solarization plans, the megawatts that are going from dirty fuel to clean energy is right now taking country support and country resources. And I said this yesterday at another bilateral meeting with another country, with the United States, of course, that we are, if Pakistan goes totally green and totally renewable today, magically, we will not, our emissions will not make an impact on the global registry, hardly any, less than 1%. So we're not big emitters. Do we get attention when we become big emitters? Sometimes it seems that way. And some of the federal secretaries in this government, bright sparks, frustrated at not being able to get local, national, or international attention for climate goals, say maybe we should become bigger emitters. Maybe then our dirty emissions will then bring in international attentions and we'll get a jet P. Don't take us on that path. It is not good for us. We need to reduce pollution as well as emissions, two different things at some points, for our own public health goals and as well as our climate goals, and also to reduce our import bills. We are, you know, we are completely vulnerable right now, for instance, to variable and volatile spot markets for even LNG. And like the green financing that is much celebrated as a path to recovery and building resilience for climate, we compete. We compete on international markets with everyone in the world, with high competence economies and planners for the gas, and we often don't get it. We compete on international markets for green financing. Should that be a competition, ladies and gentlemen, for developing countries, for the small islands, for the global south? I don't think so, at all. When you know that competing and excellence in building bankable projects is linked entirely to capacity. Is there that level of capacity? The World Bank knows better than anyone else what level of capacity there is in developing countries and economies such as ours, which are not entirely science-based. The move to science, the move to building bankable projects will come from high technical capacity. There are 10 people, not even 10, in the federal horizon who can do this work in Pakistan. Some of them are here tonight, or this morning, excuse me. Four or five are, or I can see them already. I won't name you, but I can see you all. I don't know who you are, who I'm speaking about. That's not a huge pool. And that's not going to be enough for making secretariats of ministries build the kind of funding streams that will unlock the green financing needed to change any kind of scale or game for climate and finance. So we can continue talking. I think that's very important because talk leads to action. Without talk, there's no action. And I'm assuming some thought has gone on to the talk. But in my thinking, I do want to say one last thing, that you know, the World Bank was created to really eradicate extreme poverty and build shared sustainable prosperity. Right now, both those goals are challenged by climate stress. Internationally, on the ground in Pakistan, even on your desks, you will see that all goals to do both, to follow both objectives, and with complex playouts in each country will be challenged, and completely targets and goals will be thrown off by climate change. So paying attention to it is important, but understanding that we have no actual financing to make the changes and to follow the goals we are talking about. For the first time in our lives, at least in Pakistan, we actually have plans and policies ready with actual T's that are crossed and I's that are dotted and actual planning on how to go forward. For instance, the EPA plans, those are highly technical, they're ready. There's absolutely no money to fund them. We know what to do. But there is no wherewithal for funding it. So, you know, you can have a lot of policy, you can have a lot of talk. But here we are. Adaptation remains a Cinderella topic at all big multilateral conferences. The fund itself has never been really materialized, and it literally was Cinderella at COP27 because it was past midnight when that working group was wound up. I was there, and we were trying to make a bargain for loss and damage. We had to do that in every working group. So mitigation group fell a little to the side, and we ran to the adaptation. It was past midnight. A total Cinderella issue, because that's what struggling countries need, and we don't have a big voice. Well, at least we can give them that. We'll give ourselves that. At least get a big voice out there. And we did our best to do that. But right now, before I finish, ladies and gentlemen, keep in mind, other than the big number that the World Bank has spoken about, for Pakistan by 2030, the total cost of NDC implementation will reach nearly $200 billion. $200 billion. That's not coming. If anyone tells you it's in some pipeline, please give a small respectful laugh, if you like, because it's not coming. And in saying so, I'm suggesting that it's not anybody's moral under attention that is bringing such a crisis to pass with no tools to unpack it. The world is at a complete tipping point for climate. Everybody's horrified in their own countries at their trajectory of stress, including the summers where Western Europe starts burning and 40 degrees becomes a real crisis, whereas we are struggling with 57 degrees plus here. Then it's time to ask yourself, is the international financial system created after the Second World War, served its purpose, created a Marshall Plan, revived Europe, brought the world an engine of opportunities and hope for equity and equitable development, but that's not where we are today. The 21st century has upended everything. The pandemics, the digital revolution, and now, of course, climate change. All three are borderless and are instruments for the 21st century. The IFI, the systems, the MDBs are not able to cope with the finances needed to change the game for climate change. You can't pressure countries under their own cost of living stress at this point, particularly after the Ukraine conflict. Well, people start trickling out $200 million and remind you that it's a big ask to us, seek more. Those $200 million are very welcome, but they don't scale change. They tick off the projects we all speak about in isolation, and people get funding in projects that address a few districts. That does not change the game for either the world, a region, or a country, let alone a large community. With a large population in Pakistan, these are issues we should be talking about. And while we importune our development partners who are there for us, both internationally and locally, and I really appreciate your assistance on the ground, it's time to rethink all of this. The MDB, the IFIs, the World Financial Architecture does not have the money or the thinking. The money is out there. It's not in country coffers, but it's in the system, which means the system has to change to address the challenges of the 21st century. Now, I'm not speaking of the Bridgetown agenda only. I'm speaking of a broader shift. And certainly that includes the Bridgetown agenda. And it's time to rethink the financial architecture. It is the World Bank that will be the most important by countries that are like, you're telling us that we need $348 billion to keep our head above water. Who's going to get us that money? You'll give us some, it has all become loan money. For a country that is drowning in debt and floods, where are the grants that you were created to provide? You can satisfy your audit requirements. I think that's something the Prime Minister mentioned repeatedly, especially at Geneva, where we all did very well with your help in raising money. There was great confidence in Pakistan's planning for resilience. The Climate Resilience Conference in Geneva was hugely successful. We went in asking for $4 billion, and the $4 billion to be provided by Pakistan and $8 billion was to be put to the flood recovery task. We got pledges of $9 billion, thanks to all of you and your help. But I mean, when that comes in, by the time that it goes into the PSDPs and ADBs of provinces rebuilding, I don't know if there'll be another disaster. There is not enough predictability. So to manage predictability and risk and climate shocks for the 21st century, the global financial architecture will have to change. I would urge the World Bank team to start thinking about it. Thank you very much.